Hello, everybody, and welcome back for another exciting week of Spanish grammar. This week we're talking about Chapter 9, which includes a discussion on por and para, adverbs ending in mente, and the subjunctive. Now, your book is a little strange when it comes to the subjunctive. It breaks it up into Chapters 9 and 10, which I think is kind of weird, so I'm going to go ahead and teach you the majority of what you need to know about the subjunctive in this video. And then we may add to it a little bit in Chapter 10, but for now, I at least want you to go ahead and have those basics covered. So, we'll start here with por and para. There's a variety of reasons why you might use para and a variety of reasons why you might use por. Let's talk about each one. We're going to start with para. So, as we begin, we use para to talk about deadlines and time limits, and it's often translated as for or by in these circumstances. For example, we say, necesito el pasaporte para esta tarde. So I need the passport for this afternoon. Like, I need it right now. I need it by this afternoon. I need it for this afternoon. Deadline, time limit. Okay. Pienso estar en Bristol para las tres de la tarde. So I plan to be in Bristol by 3 in the afternoon. That's my deadline, my time limit. I'm planning to be there by 3, para las tres. Okay, so deadlines, for or by. We also use para when we're talking about destinations or recipients of things. So for example, mañana salimos para la playa. So tomorrow we're leaving for the beach. That's our destination, our place. Este pasaje es para ti. This ticket is for you. Or este regalo es para ti. This present is for you, right? So that's an example of a recipient in this case. All right. As we keep going through, you see para and also the purpose of an action or an object. And in this case, we usually translate para as an order to, and it's often accompanied by an infinitive. So for example, vamos a Colombia para conocer el país. We're going to Colombia in order to get to know the country. So oftentimes translated as an order to, and generally there with an infinitive, in this case, conocer. Recall from an earlier video that an infinitive is any word that ends in AR, ER, or IR. Another use of para that's very common is when we translate it as for blanking. So for example, la cámara es para sacar fotos. The camera is for taking photos. So for blanking, para sacar fotos, for taking. Okay. Also, we use para with work objectives. And I'm going to admit, this one is a little bit strange for me. This is not one that I would ever actually use in real life. But your book has it, so I'm going to tell you about it. It says that Tony estudia para piloto, which literally means he studies for pilot. Or we would say he's studying to be a pilot. That's his work objective. Now, in my brain, I would say Tony estudia para ser piloto. And to me, I just like that better. But your book has para piloto, which is fine. And I'm telling you that in case you encounter it in my Spanish lab, para piloto, as a work objective. And finally, another very common use of para is with opinion. So para mí, for me, or in my opinion, siempre es divertido viajar. Traveling is always fun. So you can say para mí, in my opinion, para ti, for you, or in your opinion, para él, para ella, para usted. You can use it in a lot of different circumstances here. So in summary, we use para to discuss time limits and deadlines, destinations or recipients, the purpose of an action, usually translated as an order to with an infinitive, or for blanking, a work objective or opinion. So those are the reasons why we might use para. Por is honestly used quite a bit more commonly. Por is often used with duration and can be translated as during or for. For example, por ejemplo, there isn't a situation where we'd use por. Por ejemplo, we'll talk about those set phrases a little later. But for example, vamos al aeropuerto por la tarde. So we're going to the airport during the afternoon. Pienso estudiar en España por un semestre. I'm planning to study in Spain for a semester. So during that semester, during that afternoon. So duration often uses por. We also use por with motion, and in these cases, we translate por as through, by, along, or around. So use por with motion. For example, pasé por el control de seguridad. I passed through the security control, or the security checkpoint. So pasé por seguridad. Hay muchas maletas por el reclamo de equipaje. There are lots of suitcases around the baggage claim. Por el reclamo de equipaje. So, you see por used in these cases meaning through or around. In some cases you can, like this one, voy por el parque, I'm going through the park. Por is oftentimes translated as through. I see it a lot that way. You also use por with goals of actions and objects. So, vamos por usted a las dos. We'll come for you at 2 o'clock. We're coming by for you. We're coming to get you. Vamos por usted a las dos. Los estudiantes fueron por el equipaje. The students went for their luggage, or they're going to get their luggage. They're on their way. That's their purpose. They're going to get the luggage. Van por el equipaje. Okay. You also see por translated as because of or in exchange for, on behalf of. So, lo hiciste por mí? Oh my gosh, did you do it for me? Lo hiciste por mí? Or pagué $250 por el boleto? I paid $250 for the ticket or in exchange for the ticket, right? You give your money and they give you back a ticket. It's an exchange. So, in exchange for, por. And then finally, tuve que cancelar el vuelo por una emergencia. I had to cancel the flight for an emergency, or because of an emergency, I had to cancel the flight. You also use por with the means by which something is accomplished. So I translate this one as vía. I like vía. So, ¿recibiste los pasajes por correo electrónico? Did you receive the pasajes, the tickets, via email? Or hicimos las reservaciones por internet. We made the reservations via internet or by internet, over the internet, okay? And then some commonly used por expressions are por aquí, por ahora, por cierto, por Dios. We'll talk about what these mean. So I already gave you por ejemplo a moment ago. For example, you've heard por favor a lot, please. Por fin, finally. Por lo general, in general. Por supuesto, of course. Por último, finally. Por Dios, which is like for heaven's sake. Por cierto, by the way, or indeed. Por aquí, around here. Por ahora, for now. Or estar por, to be about to. These are, in summary, your uses of por and para. Okay, so lots and lots of uses here. I don't know about you, but I know when I was learning por and para in high school for the first time in Spanish 3, I wanted to pull my hair out. I was like, why are there so many different uses? I'm never going to understand this. Okay, I got so frustrated with myself. And there's just one day, and this sounds kind of silly, but it just clicks, and they all start, you know when it sounds right and when it sounds wrong. You'll just develop that confidence, okay? Until then, keep trying to spend time memorizing these rules and working with them. It does get easier the more that you practice, okay? So here are four questions relating to por and para. Let's take a look at one, and I'm going to give you a moment to try the others. So for number one, it says, teníamos pasajes blank Nueva York. We had, or we used to have, tickets for New York. So in this case, we're going to use para because New York is our destination. So teníamos pasajes para Nueva York. Blank eso, you may recall from one of our set expressions, por eso, that's why, or therefore, caminamos, blah, blah, blah. I want you to take a moment, think about these, and then we'll talk about them, okay? Go ahead and pause me. Okay, now that you've had a moment to think about these, so we used to have passes for New York, our destination. Por eso, therefore, our idiomatic expression. We walk, caminamos blank la terminal. We are going to walk through the terminal, por la terminal. y buscamos el mostrador de Avianca. So we're going to walk through the terminal and we're going to look for the counter that says Avianca. And then it says that compramos un sandwich. We bought a sandwich, blank comer en el avión. In this case, we're going to say para comer en el avión because we're talking about in order to eat on the plane, which is one of those common para expressions. In my Spanish lab this week, you may be expected to do something like this where you have to fill in a little reading with either por or para. We'll do a couple here for you as an example. Number one, buenas tardes, good afternoon. Soy Carmen Dominguez. I'm Carmen Dominguez. Y trabajo, I work blank, el periódico digital El Universal. So my name is Carmen Dominguez and I work for the periodical. In this case, we are going to say por. I work on behalf of. Trabajo por el periódico. And estoy aquí. I'm here because I'm here. Blank, aprender más sobre la carrera de este importante artista. And I'm here, blank, to learn about the career of this important artist. I'm here in order to, para aprender. So we're using in order to, it should be para. Okay, so you'll have to do some sentences like these this week. Make sure you think through the meaning of all of them. Here are just some additional practice questions for you. Anoche estudié en la biblioteca blank 3 horas. So last night I studied in the library for 3 hours. That's a duration of time. Therefore, I should use por. Estuve en Caracas blank un mes y me divertí mucho. So I was in Caracas for a month. Again, a duration of time, so I should use por. And then fui al mercado. I went to the market. Al aire libre, in the free air, the outdoors, there's a better word for that. I went to the free air market, the market outdoors, blank, disfrutar el día. In this case, again, we're saying in order to enjoy the day, para. Okay, hopefully you're beginning to feel better about your uses of por and para. Next, we're going to talk about adverbs that end in mente. Now, I want to give you a little English lesson first. A lot of people freak out when they hear adverbs. They're like, oh gosh, what's an adverb? What's an adverb? Okay, so we have adverbs in English as well. Typically, an adverb modifies a verb, an adjective, or another adverb. In English, typically, we see these written with ly. For example, you may have quick as your adjective, whereas quickly will be your adverb. Rapid and rapidly, slowly. Typically in English, you see these with ly. In Spanish, our equivalent of ly is mente, mente, M-E-N-T-E, mente. So you take a basic adjective like fácil, easy, fácil, and you add mente to the end, fácilmente. Take another adjective like alegre, happy, and add mente, alegremente, happily. Okay? In some cases, you have to change the O to an A. So lento, slow, becomes lenta, mente. So not only do you add mente, but you change the O to an A. Rápido, it's not rápido, mente. It becomes rápidamente. The O changes to an A as well, in addition to seeing the mente. These usually are not too bad for most students. Pretty easy concept overall. Some other examples in real life, you would see that Teresa canceló el vuelo inmediatamente. She canceled the flight immediately. Or Toledo, which is a ciudad in España, es particularmente bello. So Toledo is particularly beautiful. Okay, particularmente. Okay, so this little comprehension activity asks you to choose between the adjectives especial and fácil. You need to turn them into adverbs by adding mente, and you need to use them correctly in the sentences below. I'm going to give you a moment here. Go ahead and pause me and give this a try. Okay, now that you've had a moment to try these, it tells you that tenemos una guía de la ciudad. So we had a guide of the city, or we have a guide of the city, excuse me. Por eso, therefore, encontramos el museo blank. So we have a guide of the city, therefore we found the museum easily. So you're going to take fácil and you're going to add mente to the end and arrive at fácilmente. We found it very easily. Okay? It tells you that tiene una colección. It has a collection. And we're going to say special, but it's a collection that is especially extensive de artefactos precolombianos, pre-Columbian artifacts. So we're going to take especial and add mente to the end. Not terrible there, right? On my Spanish lab, you may be asked to do something like this, where you have to fill in the blank, adding the ly, the mente, and put them in the correct position, kind of like what you were doing before, just in a more extensive situation. So for example, el año pasado fui a Bogotá, last year I went to Bogotá, Colombia, para asistir a una conferencia profesional, to attend a professional conference. Me gusta viajar, I like to travel, blank por avión. So I like to travel blank by plane, either generally by plane, immediately by plane, slowly by plane, particularly by plane, or punctually by plane. I'm going to say particularly by plane. So I'm going to take particular, and I need to add mente to get my ly. Particularmente. Salí de Caracas por la mañana. So I left out of Caracas in the morning. And el vuelo llegó, it arrived blank, a las 2 de la tarde. It probably arrived punctually. So I'm going to take puntual and add mente on the end. So it arrived puntualmente. Okay. Hopefully you're feeling much better about your uses of por and para and adverbs using mente. Now we're going to talk about the subjunctive. Oh my gosh. Okay. I know I've thrown a lot at you this semester, so buckle up. This is a rather difficult topic. Okay. That's why you have these videos to help you. So we are going to talk about the subjunctive. So subjunctive, what? Okay, so the subjunctive is not a tense. I want to start by saying that. Subjunctive is a mood. It often terms gets called a tense. What people don't realize is that we have the subjunctive mood in English as well. Okay, it's often used incorrectly, and I'll talk to you about that in a moment, but we have the subjunctive mood in English just like in Spanish. Okay, you've been using the indicative mood in the past because you know the present indicative, you know the preterite and the imperfect as well, which are all part of the indicative mood. Okay, we use the indicative when we want to talk about things that are definite, factual, and real, things that don't have any type of subjectory knowledge or uncertainty to them. The indicative is used when you're 100% confident, basically. Okay, we use the subjunctive whenever we want to talk about things that are hypothetical or subjective. These are things that may or may not be true. Okay, and an example of that, sometimes we have opinions or hopes or wishes. For example, it's really good for you to exercise every day. Okay, are you going to exercise every day? I don't know. You might not. That's subjunctive. I hope that you study this stuff tonight. Well, are you gonna study it? I hope so, but I don't know if you will. So that's subjunctive. Okay, there's uncertainty. I doubt that you know where I live. Okay, do you know where I live? I don't know. I doubt it, but you might. Okay, so it's subjunctive. In English, we see the subjunctive as well. You may be familiar with the Justin Bieber song that goes like this. If I was your boyfriend, I'd never let you go. I could take you places you ain't never been before. So that's a Justin Bieber song. If I was your boyfriend, I'd never let you go, right? Well, you can see Sheldon from the Big Bang Theory down here. He has some problem with that. He's saying Justin meant if I were your boyfriend, because Justin forgot to use the subjunctive tense, okay, which again implies subjector. So we do have this subjunctive tense in English as well. It is just sometimes very commonly used, like it's commonly misused. So if I were rich, I would buy a Mercedes, okay? People say, well, if I was rich, it should be if I were rich, the subjunctive, okay? Again, we use the indicative to talk about things that are definite, real, and factual. Subjunctive to talk about things that are hypothetical. So Typically, for subjunctive to be used in a sentence, you need to have two subjects, or what I call a change of subject. You need to have a K, which is usually in the middle. You need to have some type of verb from what I call weirdo. And I'm going to talk to you about that in a moment, okay? So as we look at a sentence, you have an independent clause, which includes your first subject and your first verb, a K, and then a dependent clause, which includes your second subject and your second verb. So this sentence says, insisto en que, I insist that. Insisto en que estés en clase a tiempo. Notice it did not say estás, it said estés. I insist that you are in class on time. Now, even though I insist that you come to class on time, are you going to be on time? Maybe, maybe not. We don't know. Things happen. You might arrive late. Okay? Insisto en que estés en clase a tiempo. This triggers the subjunctive in this case because we are using a verb of influence. I insist that. And we'll talk about those in a moment. So, one more time, for the subjunctive to take place, you need to have two subjects and two verbs, what I call a change of subject. You need to have a K. You need to have some type of verb from weirdo. Okay? So, going back to those examples we have earlier, I hope that you study tonight. I hope, in this case, is my independent clause. There's one subject and one verb. I hope that, which in Spanish would be my K, and then you study tonight. You study would, in this case, be my dependent clause. So I hope that you study tonight. The you study part is what's going to be subjunctive. I hope that is just plain old indicative. I hope that, because there's no doubt about that. I do hope that you study tonight, okay? But whether or not you study, that's where the doubt occurs. So that's what's going to be subjunctive. I hope that you study tonight. I doubt that they know where I live. I doubt indicative that's my K. And then my dependent clause, they know. Do they know where I live? Maybe. Do they know where I live? Maybe not. I don't know. There's doubt, okay? So, one more time, you need a change of subject. Subject, verb, a K in the middle, and some type of verb of influence, emotion, doubt, or denial from weirdo. I've been talking a lot about this weirdo. This is an acronym. If you haven't learned anything else about me this semester, you know that I love acronyms. This acronym, weirdo, refers to wishes, emotions, impersonal expressions, requests and recommendations, doubt and denial, and the verb ojalá. Okay, so these are reasons why we might use weirdo. Here's an example from your book. Quiero que pase por el control de agricultura. So quiero que, I want that, or I want that you pase, pass, por el control de agricultura. Notice we used pase here instead of pasa. This is conjugated from the verb pasar, to pass, and it's in the usted form. So, quiero que pase. I want you to go through el control de agricultura. There are two different subjects here. Yo quiero, yo, my first subject. Usted pase, usted, my second subject. So, two subjects, two verbs. Check, check. There's a K, and there's a verb of influence. I want that this happens, okay? That, the wanting in this case, would fall under wishes, influence. Okay? As far as conjugating verbs in the subjunctive, there's a little formula that will hopefully make this easier for you. So I always tell my students, form the yo. So whatever your verb is, form the yo, drop the o, and then add the opposite ending. Okay? What I mean by opposite ending, if you are dealing with an AR verb, those AR verbs are going to use ER endings. If you're dealing with an ER or an IR verb, those verbs are going to use AR endings. Okay, so go back to Spanish 1 where you had these basic endings. Okay, with a verb like hablar, that was an AR verb, you're now instead going to use your ER ending. So instead of saying hablas, you're going to say hables. Instead of habla, you're going to say hable. Instead of hablamos, hablemos. They switch to the opposite. For a verb like comer, which was an ER verb, it's now going to use the AR endings. So instead of come, it's going to be coma. Instead of comen, it's going to be coman. Here's an example of that. Okay. Hable, hables, hable, hablemos, hables, and hablen. Notice with the subjunctive, none of these ended in O. So the él, ella, usted form and the yo forms are going to be identical. So you have to look at the context of the sentence. So one more time, AR verb endings are going to take the ER endings, and ER, IR verbs are going to take the AR endings. Okay. Now, the reason why everybody always asks, well, Mr. Harrison, why do I have to form the yo first? That's so hard. Why can't I just take off the ER and add the other ending? Well, the reason why, you have some verbs that are irregular, like tener, for example. If I just took off my ER and tener and put an A, I'd get tena. And that's not a word. So we form the yo, tengo, we drop the O, and we add the opposite ending. So tenga, tengas, tenga, tengamos, tengais, and tengan. So that's why we form the yo first, because you know all these things about irregular yo verbs and all that kind of stuff. Okay, there's a whole series of those. Digo, hago, oigo, pongo, salgo, traigo, vengo, veo. This is why you have to form the yo first, because those are regular endings. You learned before about cargars are verbs that change. When we talked about the preterite, you learned that verbs that end in car change to k. Verbs in gar change to gay, and verbs in zar change to say. That's mostly true here, except that it's really just a few letters that are changing. So my C for car verbs changes to a QU, which is how I get sake, 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 sakemos, sakes, and saken. Gar verbs, the G changes to a GU, which is how I arrive at pague, pages, pague, paguemos, pagues, and paguen. In cruzar, my Z changes to a C. So cruce, cruces, cruce, crucemos, cruces, and crucen. Because these are all AR verbs, car, gar, and zar all end in AR, using your ER endings. So E, es, E, amos, es, and N. Remember that the yo and the él, ella, usted have the exact same form. So you'll have to look at the context of the sentence to be able to tell those apart. Okay, so again, car, gar, and zar verbs, the C changes to a QU, the G changes to a GU, and the Z changes to a C. If you think about only the yo form, you can still say that car changes to K, gar changes to gay, and zar changes to say. But since we are referring to other forms now, just make sure that you don't forget the other endings. Okay, now, stem changers are also still a thing here, which is why we do tell you to form the yo first. Now, this is the tricky part. Whenever you have a verb that ends in AR or ER, this is not IR verbs, okay? Only AR and ER verbs that are stem changers in the subjunctive, you're going to do the exact same thing you do in the present indicative. So you may remember, and only stem changes when it's inside the boot. You're still doing that. These only change when they're in the boot. So the nosotros and the vosotros are not in the magical boot. So therefore, they do not stem change. So pensar, I form my yo of pienso. I've dropped my O. I've applied that in every form except for the nosotros and vosotros. My E remains an E, does not change to an IE. And then I add my opposite ending. So instead of adding an A, it's going to be an E, ES, E, amos, es, and N. So E, es, E, amos, es, N. Same thing with volver. Typically, it changes from O to UE. That happens everywhere except inside the boot. So the nosotros and vosotros remain as a U. Everywhere else, volver was an ER verb, so it's now going to use AR endings instead. So you get vuelva, vuelvas, vuelva, volvamos, volváis, and vuelvan. This is a typo from your book. That should have an N. Sorry, I just took a screenshot of that from your book. So it should be Vuelvan. Okay. So you have that. Here's a little image from your book that was interesting. Espero que llegues pronto. Now, this is a perfect example of everything we've been talking about all together. So you have two subjects. Yo espero, I hope, que tú llegues, that you arrive. So you have two subjects, you have two verbs separated by que. Boom, subjunctive. There's a weirdo verb of influence. I hope that. That's that wishing of weirdo. So I hope that you arrive soon. You have all those things together. And this is a stem change. The verb llegar was a gar verb, which means that my G changed to a GU. And it's in the to form, so it ends in ES. Espero que llegues pronto. Now, this is where we get a little tricky. If a verb is an IR stem-changing verb, we've talked about those IR stem-changing verbs before. If it's an IR stem-changing verb, you're going to follow sort of that same rule as you did in the preterite. Verbs that change from E to IE in the present tense in the subjunctive are still going to change from E to IE everywhere except the nosotros and vosotros, where in those two forms, in the nosotros and the vosotros, they change from E to I instead of E to IE. So you can see here the verb sentir, to feel, becomes sienta, sientas, sienta, sientan. But here we have sientamos and sientais. For pedir, which normally has an E to I stem change, it's still changing from E to I everywhere. No big deal there. Okay, dormir though, which normally changes from O to UE, is going to change only from O to U when it's inside, when it's outside of the boot, the nosotros and the vosotros. So duerma, duermas, duerma, durmamos, durmais, and duerman. Okay, so very careful there. One last time, verbs that end in AR or ER and have stem changers in the present tense, they are going to stem change everywhere except for the nosotros and vosotros, where they just stay normal. Nothing happens to them in the nosotros and the vosotros. But for an IR stem changing verb, they all still change everywhere except in the nosotros and vosotros, they have less of a stem change. So instead of E to IE, it's only E to I in the nosotros and vosotros. Instead of O to UE, it's just O to U inside of the nosotros and vosotros, okay? Like with anything else, you have irregular verbs. And I like to give my students the acronym DISHES, D-I-S-H-E-S, to remember your subjunctive irregulars. Dar, ir, ser, haber, estar, and saber are all of my subjunctive irregulars. And you can see their conjugations here for you. So they, des, they, demos, des, den. Vaya, vayas, vaya, vayamos, vayais, and vayan. Sea, seas, sea, seamos, seais, and sean. So on and so forth. So you'll want to take note to memorize these in the subjunctive. Okay, I've given you a ton of information here. So let's take a moment, and I want you to just practice some of these that you see here. So this is purely just practice with conjugating in the subjunctive. Remember our rules. You're going to form the yo, drop the o, and then add the opposite ending. So number one gives you el avión and despegar, the plane, and to take off. El avión, despegar. So as we go through here, you need to first form the yo, drop the o, and the opposite. So the yo form of despegar, oh, I don't want to give you all the answers. The yo form of despegar is going to be despego with an O, D-E-S-P-E-G-O. You want to drop the O and you want to add the opposite ending. So you would think you would just add an E because of plane being it in my bottom left box. So you would think you would end up with despegue with an E. However, this is a gar verb, and you know that with gar verbs, the G changes to a GU. or guard changes to gay. So it should end up as your final answer being despegue. We just changed here mostly for pronunciation. So despegue. Okay, I want you to go through and try numbers 2 through 9 on your own. Go ahead and pause me. Give this a try, and we'll come back together in just a moment. Okay, now that you've had a moment to try these, I would like for us to talk about these. We already talked about number 1. With number 2 and hacer, you're going to form the yo. The yo form of hacer should be hago. You're going to drop the O and add the opposite ending. So it was an ER verb. Normally our ending would be ES, but instead we're going to add AS, hagas. Number 3, salir. You're going to form the yo, which would be salgo. Drop your O. Normally, for an IR verb, we use E as our ending, but instead we're going to use an A. So it should be salga. Los niños en pescar. Notice that pescar is a car verb. So ellos pescar, they fish, form the yo form, pesco, drop the O, and add the opposite ending. So instead of AN, we're going to add EN. So you're very close, but don't forget your additional step here, that the C changes to a QU, because car verbs become K. So instead of pesen, we get pesken, pesken. Numbers 5 and 6 are both irregular. Our friends and estar, instead of estan, it becomes estén. Tú and ir, instead of vas, it becomes vayas. So on and so forth. You can see all of these worked out for you here. One last one I want to talk about is number 9. Nosotros en dormir, we and to sleep. You need to form the yo form of dormir, duermo. Drop the O and add the opposite ending. So instead of emos or imos, we're going to add amos. So duermamos is very close. Remember, though, this is an IR verb that in the present tense has a stem change from O to UE. So therefore, in the subjunctive mood, you're only going to stem change from O to U in the nosotros form. So it should become durmamos, durmamos. So very careful there. Guys, these are hard. Okay, there's lots of rules, lots of memorizing. I know your brain probably feels like it's going to explode. So take advantage of the Conjuguemos site. It's a great place to go and practice if you need help. Okay, I want you just to tell me in these sentences if the verb used in the dependent clause, that is the verb after the K, if it is indicative or subjunctive. Number 1, espero que vayas conmigo a Cartagena. So vayas, indicative or subjunctive? Good, should be subjunctive. Number 2, creo que el hotel es muy lindo. I think that the hotel is very cute. Es, subjunctive or indicative? Indicative, indicative, normal. No es cierto que dormamos al aire libre. Dormamos, subjunctive or injunctive? It should be subjunctive. Okay. As far as my Spanish lab goes, you may have to do something similar to this for my Spanish lab. It's given you some type of verb of influence in the beginning. We'll talk more about those in a moment. But I need, necesito, que, that, tú, that you ir al supermercado, that you go to the supermarket. You may remember from dishes that ir is irregular and that the two forms going to be vayas. So necesito que tú vayas al supermercado. Queremos que ellos venir a la fiesta. So we want that they go to the party. We want them to go. Form the yo, vengo, drop the O, add the opposite ending. So instead of adding an EN, we're going to add an AN. Quiero que ellos vengan a la fiesta. Haber is part of dishes. It is one of your irregular verbs. It becomes haya in all the various forms. So Carlos desires that there's more time. He wants there to be more time. Desea que haya más tiempo. Okay, so on and so forth. As we continue looking at the Spanish subjunctive tense, you see, we're going to start here with wishes primarily, okay? And under wishes, we have things like I want, I hope, I desire, I insist, I need, I advise, I recommend, those kind of things. And We call these verbs of influence. So these are the most common ones you're going to see. Aconsejar, to advise. Decir, to tell. Desear, to desire, to wish. Another one that's not listed here. Esperar, to hope. Insistir in, I insist that. Mandar, to order. Necesitar, to need. Pedir, to ask. Permitir, to permit. Prohibir, to prohibit. Querer, to want. Recomendar, to recommend. And sugerir, to suggest. With all of these verbs, you have the same situation, so to speak. You still have an independent clause, a K, and a dependent clause. Again, notice we specify that there should be two subjects. Okay, subject one, verb one, K. Subject two, verb two. The second verb is going to be in the subjunctive tense, the verb in the dependent clause. So tú quieres que, you want that. Notice quieres is in the indicative. There's no doubt about it. You want for me to travel with you. Quiero que yo viaje contigo. So they took viajar, which is normally an AR verb, chopped off the AR, added an O, took away the O, and added the opposite ending. So instead of adding an A, they added an E. So tú quieres que yo viaje contigo. You want me to go with you. This is where ojalá also comes in, which is very similar. Ojalá, I learned, is actually an Arabic word. It comes from Arabic, and it comes from the Arabic word meaning God willing. So ojalá que, it just means I hope that or I wish that. So ojalá que visitemos California. So I hope that we visit California. Instead of visitamos, we just switch the A to an E because it's subjunctive. I hope that, in my independent clause, triggers the subjunctive in the dependent clause because ojalá is part of weirdo. Just like wishes, we're also part of weirdo. So I hope that visitemos California. I hope that you go tomorrow. Ojalá que vayas mañana. Instead of saying in the indicative, vas, we've used vayas. I hope that you go tomorrow. Because again, I hope that having a weirdo verb in the independent clause triggers the subjunctive in the dependent clause. Kind of tricky. The I here, weirdo, refers to impersonal expressions. These are most commonly used with K. Like, es bueno que, it's good that, es importante que, it's important that, es imposible que, it's impossible that, es indispensable que, it's crucial that, es mejor que, it's better that, es necesario que, it's necessary that, es precioso que, es precio que, it's essential that, es preciso que, excuse me, es preciso que, it's essential that, es urgente que, it's urgent that, so on and so forth. Lots of impersonal expressions. Usually you have an es, an adjective, and a que. And these generally do require the use of the subjunctive. You see some others here, like es extraño que, es fácil que, es fantástico que, so on and so forth. You can read through these in your text. As far as what you'll be asked to do with these, you're going to need to go through and select the correct verb in a series. So tus amigos, your friends, there's our first subject, te aconsejan, they advise you that you, there's our second subject, so your friends advise you that you blank a lot of photos on your trip. The two verbs you've been given are buscar, to look for, or sacar, to take. We're saying that your friends advise that you take a lot of photos on your trip. So we're going to use our verb, which in this case is sacar. We're going to form the yo, which is saco. We're going to drop our o. We're going to add the opposite ending. So sacar was an AR verb. We would normally add AS, but instead we're going to add ES. And you may also recall that sacar is a car verb. So my C is going to change to a QU. And I should arrive at my final answer of saques. Saques. Another example. Su abuelo le recomienda a Julio que blank para su examen. So his grandfather recommends to Julio that he study for his exam. So we have one verb, one subject. This verb, recomendar, falls under weirdo. It's a recommendation. So, and then we have a second subject after our K. So his grandfather recommends that he study. So we have our two verbs, our two subjects, a K and a weirdo word. So we're going to use the subjunctive. In this case, he recommends that he study, estudiar. I'm going to chop off my AR, form the yo, estudio, drop the O, and add the opposite ending. So instead of adding an A like we normally would for estudiar, we're going to add an E. So we hope that he study, que estudie. Okay, hopefully you're feeling better about these. Another example you might have to do relating to these impersonal expressions and recommendations, wishes, all these things we've talked about under weirdo, you're going to have to match up a conversation to select the best option. So, for example, un amigo tiene una clase de física este semestre. I have a friend who has a physics class this semester. Es muy difícil para él. It's very difficult for him. En le sugiero, to or for him, I suggest that. So I've got my first subject, got my first verb. I'm suggesting to him that he, got my K, got a new subject. I suggest falls under my wishes. I'm hoping that, or maybe even a recommendation, I'm suggesting that. So I'm suggesting that blank. So he has a really difficult physics class. I need to suggest that he do something from this list. Take a moment and pause your audio to figure out what that might be. Okay, so I'm suggesting that he study for at least an hour every day. Estudie in the subjunctive. Look at one more. Number two says that mi hermano menor, my younger brother, quiere comprar un coche. He wants to buy a car, pero no tiene mucho dinero. But he doesn't have a whole lot of money. Yo le recomiendo, okay? I, to or for him, recommend that he, blank. So I recommend that he do something. So I am recommending, that's a subjunctive trigger. Got two subjects and two verbs. So I recommend that he, blank. Take a moment, see if you can figure out the answer here. Go ahead and pause me. Okay, hopefully you chose letter A. So he doesn't have a lot of money. I recommend that. Encuentre un trabajo. He find a job. So I'm taking the verb encontrar, forming the yo. It does have a stem change, so it becomes encuentro, dropping the O, and then adding the opposite ending. So recomiendo que encuentre un trabajo, that he find a job. So on and so forth. Okay. The E area of weirdo refers to feelings and emotions. Okay. And there's a series of verbs here that often trigger our feelings and our emotions and also trigger the subjunctive. So a very common one is alegrarse de, to be glad that. You hear a lot of people say, oh, me alegro de que estés bien. I'm very happy that you're good. Me alegro de que. Makes me happy that, makes me glad that. You also have the verb enojar, to be angry. Esperar, to hope, which kind of goes along with wishes up there. Estar contento or contenta de, to be happy that. Lamentar, to regret. Molestar, to bother. Sentir, which literally is to feel or to regret as well. Sorprender, to surprise. Temer, to fear. And tener miedo de, to be afraid of. All of these are feelings that may trigger the subjunctive tense. An example, me alegro de is in the indicative in my independent clause. I have a K. And now in my second verb here, which happens to be in my dependent clause, it does trigger the subjunctive because you had in your independent clause a feeling or an emotion, which is part of weirdo. You have a K. Two verbs and two subjects. So, me alegro de que te sientas mejor. I'm glad that you feel better. Te sientas. Or, es una lástima que. That's an impersonal expression. It's a shame that no podamos acompañarte al médico. It's a shame that we were not able to go with you, to accompany you to the doctor. In this case, it's a shame that is an impersonal expression in my independent clause. There's a K and a change of subject in my next dependent clause here. So I'm going to use the subjunctive. Okay, so be very, very careful here, guys. Here's another example from your book. It says, temo que, I fear that. Okay, so there's my first subject, yo, my first verb, there's a K, tu hija, your daughter, so there's a change of subject. So we have everything we need, but is there a weirdo verb? Temo que, what's that mean again? I fear that. Oh, and that's a feeling, okay, an emotion. So yeah, that's definitely a weirdo verb. So temo que, I feel that, or I'm worried that, I'm afraid that, your daughter has, tenga, una infección de oído. She has an ear infection. So in this case, we're using the subjunctive with tenga. As far as applying these this week, you're going to have to fill in the correct form preceding the verb, deciding if it triggers the subjunctive or not. Number one tells you that blank visiten todos los parques de atracciones en un fin de semana. And your options are siento que, I feel that they visit all the parks, all the amusement parks in a weekend. Or es imposible que, it's impossible that they visit all the parks in a weekend. Or me alegro de que, it makes me happy that they visit all the parks in a weekend. So as you're looking here and you finish the sentence, why do they not just stay for the whole week? It makes sense that your answer here would be es imposible que. It's impossible that they visit all the parks in one weekend. Why don't they just stay for a week? Okay. I want you to pause me, and I'd like for you to try numbers 2 and 3 for me, por favor. Okay. Now that you've had a moment to try these, number 2 says, blank, me compres algún recuerdo de tu viaje. So something, me compres, you buy me, algún recuerdo, some kind of souvenir, de tu viaje. So espero que, I hope that you buy me some kind of souvenir. Temes que, you fear that you buy me some kind of souvenir. Or lamento que, I regret that you buy me some kind of souvenir. The most logical solution here would be espero que, I hope that you buy me. And all of our conditions are present for this verb to be in the subjunctive. We have two verbs, I hope and you buy. And we are separated by K. I hope falls under the wishes category of weirdo. So we do need the subjunctive. Number 3. Blank, ustedes se quedan en un hotel de lujo. So something, you all stay in a luxury hotel. And then normalmente tu padre no quiere gustar mucho en hoteles. So blank, you all stay in a luxury hotel. And then normally your dad doesn't want to spend a whole lot of money on hotels. So letter A says, es lógico que, it's logical that you all stay in a luxury hotel. Or B, les molesta que, bothers you all that you stay in a luxury hotel. Or C, es sorprendente que, it's surprising that you all stay in a luxury hotel. In this case, it's surprising that is the correct answer. And it triggers the subjunctive because why? What portion of weirdo would es sorprendente que fall under? Good. It should be an impersonal expression. Okay. Guys, we're wrapping up. I know this is a lot of information. As far as my Spanish lab and any exams might go this week, or next week, I should say, you're going to be filling in sentences, deciding if the verb needs to be in the subjunctive or in the indicative. Let's look at number 1. Ojalá que, I hope that mi familia llegara a tiempo. I hope that my family arrives on time. I hope that is my first subject. It's also a subjunctive trigger because it's the O, ojalá. I hope that my family, my second subject, arrives. So my dependent clause has the verb llegar here, which is going to need to be conjugated in the subjunctive because you had a subjunctive trigger, two verbs, and a change of subject. So that my family arrive, llegar, I'm going to form my yo, I'm going to drop my o. Normally I would add an a because it's an ar verb, but in this case I'm going to add an e. Not quite finished yet because llegar was a gar verb. So I need to make it llegué. The G changes to a GU. So ojalá que mi familia llegue a tiempo. I would like for you to pause this for just a moment, and I want you to try number six. Number six. Okay, now that you've had a moment to try these, number six tells you that me molesta que. It bothers me that. So there's my first subject and my first verb. I also have a que. It bothers me that ellos, second subject, fumar tantos cigarros. It bothers me that they smoke so many cigarettes. So it bothers me that they. Which letter of weirdo might this fall in? It bothers me. Yeah, that's an emotion. Okay, so we do have a subjunctive trigger. So it bothers me that they smoke. For fumar, I'm going to form my yo, fumo, drop my O. I need to add the opposite ending. Normally you would add an AN, but instead here we're going to add an EN. So me molesta que ellos fumen tantos cigarros. It bothers me that they smoke so much. Okay, the only real areas we haven't discussed so far are doubt and denial. And this is where it tends to get a little confusing for some students. So some commonly used verbs that you see here are dudar, to doubt, negar, to deny, no pensar, not to think, no creer, not to believe, and no estar seguro de que, to not be sure of. You also see some common and personal expressions here. No es verdad que, it's not true that. Es increíble, it's incredible that. No es cierto que, it's not certain that. Or es dudoso que, it's doubtful that. Be very, very, very careful with these. Okay? If you say, I believe that the sky is blue, I believe does not have any doubt. Okay, you're saying you believe something. There's no doubt there. Same thing. I think, yo pienso. Okay, I think that the sky is blue. No doubt. So those are going to be completely indicative. Yo creo que el cielo es azul. Yo pienso que el cielo es azul. All right? But when you say, I don't think that, I don't believe that, it triggers doubt. So, no creo que el cielo sea azul. No pienso que el cielo sea azul. Okay? So, if you're saying you don't think, or you don't believe, or it's not true, or it's not certain, then you're going to use the subjunctive. But if you're saying, I believe that, I think that, it's true that, those things are going to use the indicative. Just be very careful. Your book gives you some examples on this one. It shows you that no es cierto, okay? It's not true that Camilo padezca de arthritis. So it's not true that Camilo is suffering from arthritis. It's not true, okay? No es cierto in this case triggers the subjunctive. You're saying it's not true. No creo que el médico sepa el diagnóstico. I don't think that the doctor knows the diagnosis. I don't think. El médico niega que mera dosis de vitaminas beneficie la salud. So the doctor denies that a megadose of vitamins benefits your health or is beneficial for your health. In this case, you have your subjunctive trigger, you have your two changes of verbs, and you have your que. So you have a subjunctive verb here. Another example from your book, it tells you exactly what I said, that when there's no doubt or uncertainty, that you're using the indicative. So with the same sentences, es cierto que Camilo padece de arthritis. It's true that she suffers. There's no doubt there. She's suffering. It's true. I think that the doctor knows the diagnosis. There's no doubt. He knows. Creo que el médico sabe el diagnóstico. The doctor does not deny that a megadose of vitamins is beneficial for your health. El médico no niega. Okay, he does not deny. He has no doubt that that megadose is good for your health. El médico no niega que una megadosis de vitaminas beneficia la salud. Gotta be real careful with these. We've talked about these a little bit. This is tricky too. So if you're using the verb creer, which means to believe or to think, and you expect someone to give you a negative response, you need to use the subjunctive and the dependent clause of your sentence. If you don't really have an opinion or you don't expect a negative response, you're going to use the indicative. Okay, so for example, the verb here is afectar, to affect. And with the first one, we're saying, ¿Crees que el alcohol afecte el corazón? Do you believe that alcohol affects the heart? You're already implying that it does. And this is very common from reporters and journalists and that kind of thing. In Spanish, if they're trying to get you to sway a certain way in your response, they may ask the question this way. So, do you believe that el alcohol afecte in the subjunctive? Whereas, if you want to, you don't really have an opinion or you want to give the person an opportunity to answer, ¿Crees que el alcohol afecta el corazón? In the indicative, do you think that it affects the heart? Okay, we've already talked about these. Remember, you are going to use the subjunctive. You're saying, I doubt that. I don't believe that. Those kind of things, you're going to use the subjunctive. Whereas when you're saying, I don't doubt that, or I believe that, I'm sure that, those things you're going to use the indicative. So just be careful there. You also can use the indicative or the subjunctive with tal vez and quizás. So tal vez funcione. No comer tanto azúcar. So perhaps funcione, it works or it functions not to eat so much sugar. Okay, so there's doubt here. You're not sure if it'll work or not. So tal vez funcione from the verb funcionar to function. They've conjugated it with the subjunctive here, funcione. And then quizás el ejercicio me haga sentir mejor. Perhaps or maybe. Exercise will make me feel better. It might not. We don't know. There's doubt or uncertainty. So, quizás el ejercicio me haga sentir mejor. I would like for you to stop for a moment, pause your audio, and give these three questions a try to see how you're doing. Okay? You need to use either the subjunctive or the indicative for necesitar, ser, and tener. Okay, now that you've had a moment to try these, this is a person speaking, it's a doctor, and she says, Creo que usted blank una infección del oído, pero dudo que blank grave. Tal vez blank una inyección. So I think that you blank an ear infection. I think that you have. Go back and consult. If you're saying, I think that, you're using the indicative. So I think that you have an ear infection. Que usted tiene. This is going to be in the indicative mood. I think that you have. There's no doubt. You have an ear infection. But dudo que, I doubt that it's pretty awful. I doubt that it's grave, grave, serious. Dudo que sea grave. Okay, because this is subjunctive. I doubt that. There's obviously doubt present because you're saying, I doubt that. Okay, number three, perhaps blank una inyección. Perhaps you need, okay, there's some doubt here. Perhaps you need. So necesitar, form the O, drop the O, add the opposite ending. Instead of an A, you're going to add an E. So tal vez necesite una inyección. And it was necesite here because of the usted form. Okay, one of the things you might be asked to do this week in on a test or on my Spanish lab, you might be asked to go through and figure out if the verb should be subjunctive or indicative and conjugate it correctly, which is what you're doing here. Okay, so this is exactly what we were doing before. Number one says, creemos que ellos blank dejar de fumar. So we believe that they are able to stop smoking. So, we believe that. Remember, creer que, believing that, is indicative. So we believe that they are able to stop smoking. We're going to take poder and use the indicative. Creemos que ellos pueden dejar de fumar. We think they can stop smoking. Number two, ellos dudan que yo hacer ejercicio todos los días. I want you to take a moment and pause me for just a moment and give this a try. Okay, now that you've had a moment, they think that I exercise every day, or they doubt that I exercise every day. Obviously, there's doubt present. They're saying they doubt that. I exercise. So I am using the subjunctive form, the yo, drop the o, and the opposite ending. Instead of adding an e, I'm going to add an a. So ellos dudan que yo haga ejercicio todos los días. They doubt that I exercise every day. Okay, what about number three? It tells you, no creo que. I do not believe that. Ooh, okay, so think back. I believe that. That's indicative. I don't believe that. That's subjunctive. Okay, so I don't believe that María parecer de depresión. I don't believe that she suffers from depression. In this case, I don't believe that should trigger the good, the subjunctive. So parecer, you're going to form the yo, which is parezco with a zco. I'm going to drop my o, and I need to add the opposite ending. So instead of adding an e, I'm going to add an a. So I doubt that she suffered. Que parezca de depresión. Okay? Hoping you're feeling better about these guys. Be proud of yourself. The subjunctive is very hard. It tells you here, yo quiero que tú estudies para el examen de español. So yo quiero que tú estudies. I want you to study. Okay, this is hard. Quiero que tú estudies. Now be careful. Verb one, subject one. Okay, subject two. Verb two is going to be in the subjunctive in the dependent clause. Another example. Me sorprende que. It surprises me that. Oh, it surprises me. There's an emotion. Subjunctive. It surprises me that todo el mundo, the whole world, no use el subjuntivo correctamente. It surprises me that the whole world doesn't use the subjunctive correctly. Again, instead of usa, we said use, because this is the subjunctive tense. And lastly, be very, very proud of yourself. The subjunctive is very, very hard, okay? If you have any questions, as always, feel free to let me know. Have a great week, guys.